I cannot think of a project right now where there is not some AI component to it.
Hello, Ernesto. How are you doing?
Hello, Pierre.
So, Ernesto, you are the head, the global head of the media and entertainment practice at BCG.
Yes.
And I'd like to take this opportunity of us being in Cannes to understand how companies are actually using AI today in the world of media, entertainment, creative industries.
Perfect. So they're using AI in many ways, different level of maturity, but everybody is using AI. Let's start from that. I think the key thing is to what extent. So the areas where everybody is using AI is support functions. So finance, HR, legal, IT, and so on. The reason being that those are areas where the risks are really lower.
Yeah.
And it's less controversial to use AI there. And the main goal that is to standardize, find efficiencies, and automate things more.
Right.
Then you have the core business. And there are two really main streams there. There is the creative industries, where they're not using AI as much. They're still using it to some extent, but because of ethics and because of IP and because of the relationship with the creators, it's a little bit controversial there. So it's a little bit more of a safer approach, like slower. And then there are other industries where there's less creativity involved. It's still media, but it's dealing with IP that they own or IP that is more standard and there is not as much IP rules that they need to respect. So in those areas, they're using AI to automate the time it takes and the cost it takes to create content. So think of news, think of textbooks, and similar. So in those areas, even though that's the core business, those companies are using AI.
So it's interesting, like a lot of things you're saying here are fascinating, especially when you started to say they use it for support functions because it's less risky. That's, to me, a little weird in a way. Is it really less risky to use AI when you do finance, legal, HR?
When I say risky, I mean you're not exposed to what your customers or your creators are going to say. Because as you know, in Hollywood, there's a lot of debate about the fair use of AI. So they're using AI also in the core business. It's just that they're doing pilots. They're rolling it out more slowly. But there is a lot of applications of AI, for example, in FX, in post-production, in editing. There are many places where they're using it. It's just that they're going slower. And you're not seeing it being used to the large scale that we're seeing, for example, in IT, in tech, where there is now a big rollout of Copilot. So, right. And there is expectations of big efficiencies.
Mostly to automate software development?
Yes.
Do you see this as potentially killing a lot of jobs, to be honest? Like, let's have an honest conversation.
Yeah, I think entry-level jobs, yes.
Entry-level jobs.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, I think you still need the upper layers because you need to monitor, you need to control, you need to ensure that there is the right data governance, the right guardrails, that the use of AI is consistent with the strategy of the firm. So entry-level, yes.
So we're seeing in the US, for instance, like a lot of statistics showing that entry-level jobs are disappearing. It's very difficult for people out of college to find jobs, even from top-notch universities. Do you see this already happening? For instance, at BCG, does it have an impact already? I started as a consultant. A lot of the stuff that I was doing at the time when I started was, you know, taking minutes, doing some research, things that are vastly automated now with AI, right? So how does it work?
So there are two ways in which you can make value out of the AI. One is to hire less and find efficiencies. And then there is another way, which is to do more with the people you already have.
Mm-hmm.
So at BCG, we're definitely using AI to do more with the people we have, and we're continuing to hire. Maybe we're hiring less than we would have without AI, but we continue to grow, we continue to hire. Because at the end of the day, the business is growing, and we need the talent to use AI in the right way. What is changing is that we're using AI to automate some of those tasks that are not as value-added. I'll give you an example. Today, we have a big repository of data and documents, which is all the prior work we've done with the right levels of safety and security and privacy. As a consultant now, you have a chatbot and you engage with the chatbot to understand what prior work has been done that is relevant. Before, you had to use a traditional search methodology to find the materials, then you had to read it to understand whether it was relevant or not. Now the AI is doing that for you. So that's much faster. So that's an example of the productivity improvement. Another example is that we used to spend a lot of time drafting the story of a presentation, and then you have to create the slides one by one. We now have a tool called Dexter that creates the first draft of the presentation for you end-to-end in PowerPoint with content, with some prompts based on some proprietary content that BCG has. So these are two concrete examples of how we're using AI to augment what the consultants are doing.
Yeah, in project management, we're seeing the same thing, right? Many reports are being automated. You can spend less time doing the pure production of outputs and focus more on managing stakeholders, managing risk, building your team. So Ernesto, I'd like to understand now from your standpoint and what you're seeing. So you're managing so many AI transformation projects. How much of that is your current business, by the way? How much of your business is about AI transformation today? Just for us to get a sense of how top of mind it is for the C-suite for
those. I can tell you about my personally work. I don't know. I don't have the data at the finger of how much AI work BCG is doing. It's a lot. For me, it's a majority of the work I'm doing.
Majority.
I cannot think of a project right now where there is not some AI component to it, but the AI transformations are majority of the work I'm doing for sure.
And so how do your clients typically manage these projects? They are usually complex, corporate-wide. Are the outcomes very clear? Do they apply proper project management techniques, or is it completely experimental? Like, how does it work?
Companies are doing it in very different ways. So there is not one or two ways in which they're doing it. At BCG, we believe that AI transformation is 10% technology, 20% tools and processes, but 70% is change management, people. So obviously, we have clients with the end-to-end transformation. The technology has to be the right one and the processes have to be in place. But we spend a lot of time with change management. The reason is that change is hard. People like doing things in certain ways and they want to change the way that they do things. Also, it's scary because many people don't know how to use AI in the right way. And it's not easy to upskill so many people quickly. So we spend a lot of time on the people side of the equation. And in terms of project management, we treat it as a transformation as we used to treat those transformations in the past with other innovations that we've experienced. So we have a dedicated team of consultants that spends a lot of time really engaging the customers to ensure that also the change is driven by the organization as opposed to imposed by us. That's for the biggest mistake I see, that sometimes consultants may come in and enforce things top down, then they have a 200-page document that tells you everything to do, then the moment we leave, nothing happens.
Yeah.
So that's the wrong way of doing it. So the way we do it, we work side by side with customers. It takes longer. Sometimes it's frustrating because we wish things move faster, but we need to make sure that this is a co-creation and customers have to buy into the idea.
And anything really unique to AI transformation projects, for instance, for us at PMI, what we're seeing is you need to have probably more attention to data, to governance, to privacy issues, to ethical concerns, to sustainability, consequences of this. And also because the technology is not stable, it's evolving very fast. Those projects tend to be a little bit more fuzzy in terms of what are the outcomes that you're expecting. So you have more agility maybe in the way you operate. Do you also see that?
Absolutely. So responsible AI is a big topic for sure. Data infrastructure, data governance is extremely important because if you don't have the right data in the right place, you cannot really use it in the AI world. The agile for sure, because you're doing a pilot using a specific LLM and maybe 6 months you need to change. So you need to make sure that you have enough flexibility to test and update as you go.
Yeah. And by the way, we have our own now AI project management certification, CPMAI.
I'm not surprised you do.
Yeah, it's many of the things are the same, but you do have some specificities, definitely. Which leads me to another, maybe even broader topic. Do you think that AI is changing the way companies are managed? Are companies more agile by nature, trying to implement a technology that is not fully baked yet and without knowing exactly what the use cases will be like? Do you feel this need for more corporate agility, or do you feel that on the contrary, because you operate in such an uncertain environment, you need more structure than ever?
It's a great question. I don't know if there is one answer for all companies. For sure, everybody has to change. how you change it depends. And I can tell you that I've seen a couple of archetypes. There is some archetypes where the clients are deciding to centralize things because they want to gain scale and they want to make sure that there is one way of doing AI and that investment will yield ROI for all the businesses and the products they have. That's one way of doing it, and that allows you to have scale, to have consistency, to ensure that the correct governance is in place, that the responsible AI principles are respected and so on. There is another approach, which is a little bit the extreme, is that you have each product or each business actually experimenting with it.
Yeah.
And what that means is that you might have more innovation, more pilots, but then it might be harder to scale and to have synergies across the businesses. These are two extremes.
Have you seen anything work better so far?
It really depends. I think you need both. In an ideal world, you are in a world where each business feels that there is freedom and autonomy to innovate. But when things work, then you can quickly scale them up so that you can invest behind it. Because one of the problems I've noticed is that there are a lot of pilots.
Yeah.
But then pilots are not being adopted.
That's where you need project management.
That's where you need project management. That's where you need the framework so that companies can work differently, so that they can invest in different things, but then pick those that are worth scaling up.
Yeah. Last question, Ernesto. Last time I met with you, I ran into you, remember, in this hotel in Tokyo. You had a very global...
Yes, I remember.
Yeah, so you're a very global person as well. You see companies from all across the globe. Do you see any differences? Like, or is corporate America... Let's put the Chinese world a little bit on the side. They have their own tools, their own rules. But is the rest of the world really driven by what's happening in the US? Or are you seeing a lot of innovation from other continents as well?
I'm seeing innovation from everywhere.
Yeah.
In different ways. For sure, the US is leading. But a lot of innovation is coming from Asia. And it also depends on the industry. I'll give you an example. So in gaming, which is a big part of the work we do at BCG, a lot of innovation around AI, but not just AI, is coming from Asia. Right. So a lot of my clients...
Were Japan, Korea,
China as well. China. And so a lot of new concepts and new applications are coming from there. In the world of social commerce, Asia is also taking the lead. And how AI is in being used in the world of social media and social commerce, I think Asia is taking the lead. So I think that nowadays you cannot just expect the US to be the leader. Great ideas, great applications can come from anywhere.
Do you see like a difference in terms of how bold certain cultures are in terms of using AI and others more conservative, have more ethical concerns? Like, do you see those differences?
Yeah, I think it depends on the industry for sure. But I may be wrong, but based on my conversations, I think Japan is a little bit more conservative in the approach and how they're investing in AI. They're investing, but probably taking a slower approach. I think it's also cultural.
Yeah, they have also cultural like attention to quality, doing things right, in the right order.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think Japan is one where maybe they're having an approach of safe, slowing it out slowly, make sure that it works. Other places, I think they're moving faster. They're willing to take more risks and fail. It's cultural differences. But even within those countries, I'm sure there are differences. So I don't think we can assume that all companies behave similarly in a specific country. But yes, maybe there are some differences.
You think AI is a fad in 1 or 2 years?
Not at all. Not at all. I'm personally taking classes myself to make sure that I'm up to date. And it was so hard to go back. And I'm doing it online.
You should take your PMP and some project management certification.
Well, if I only knew the person to say about it.
Thank you so much, Ernesto.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to be here.